Okay. The last episode of Ham Radio Now, it's episode 193, Digital Voice is Exploding, was about digital voice, I guess you could tell. This episode of Ham Radio Now, Ham Radio Now, episode 194, the HT of the future. This is also going to be about digital voice. I'll get into that in a minute. And the next episode of Ham Radio Now is also going to be about digital voice. That's not the only thing that we do, but it seems to be the thing that we do right now. I'll get to that stuff in just a minute. There's a couple things I need to finish up on that been piling up on my, piling up on my little assembly desk here. This stuff is Weed Eater Line. Talked about using Weed Eater Line as antenna support. And the reason I'm bringing it up now is my dipole fell down again. I think I talked about this in a previous episode of the program where the dipole fell down. One side of the Weed Eater Line broke. And so Jeff and I put it back up and we doubled up the Weed Eater Line. Yeah, I know I talked about that. And then the other side fell down, so we doubled up on that side. This is the Weed Eater Line from the other side that that broke and fell down. And here's the cut. Here's where it broke. And what was odd is that it stretched thin a few inches down from where it broke. So don't know why it broke where it did. I haven't given up on Weed Eater Line. My dipole is 150 feet long, and there's the trees that it's going between. There's a lot of line on one side and only a little bit on the other. Both sides broke. So, again, I'm not giving up on it. Just decided to double the strength. This is the line that I use, the Husqvarna Titanium Force. Wait a minute. Titanium Force. let's see. Somewhere around here. Oh, the 0.095 diameter. That's the stuff that we use. It's the thickest I could find. There is a problem with this stuff, and it is that it is serrated. As Jeff calls it, pre-weakened. You can see the little divots in it. I'm not sure why they do that. You know, this stuff is not, its purpose in life is not to hold up antennas. Its purpose in life is to whack weeds. You know, that little weed eater thing that you whee and cuts the grass. It's not designed to last a long time. It just turns out that it's got some properties that Jeff discovered some time ago. Jeff, AC4ZO, discovered some time ago that make it at least what we thought was pretty good for hanging dipoles with. Strong. It's not UV resistant, so that's part of the problem after it's been up for a few years. It can get a little bit on the brittle side. And very stretchy. So if the dipole's out in the wind, it will stretch. And until my recent experience, it hadn't really broken. We don't like the little serrations, the stuff that Jeff calls pre-weakened, because we're kind of afraid that's where it's going to break. But it's turned out that's not where it's broken in the times that it has broken on me. So I think, you know, maybe doubling up the strength is going to help. I will let you know, and I will let you know if I give up on it. The reason that I'm still using this is that we're finding fewer and fewer of the really thick versions of the Weed Eater Line that that have this kind of strength and are not and are round or circular and are not splined or square, stuff that would have a hard time going through the arm of a tree where the branch is coming off the trunk. That's typically where they end up sitting. So that's the problem that we're having, and this is just a further report on the episodes of Gary's dipole falling down. Both ends fell down. Both have been doubled up in strength, and we'll see if that solves the problem. All right, digital voice. lot of digital voice programs here on Ham Radio Now, more than anybody else is putting out there. And again, it's not all we do. Let me prove it's not all we do. You know, the CW Geek there, Hams and RVs, CQ, the Internet, Flex Radio, not really digital voice, but you know, it's, you know, sort of like it. So maybe it's because of all of the association that I've gotten with the Tapper conferences and stuff, but I'm paying more careful attention to digital voice than most other ham radio media is. I'm not a big digital voice operator. I've got some D-Star radios. I've been doing D-Star almost since the beginning of D-Star. But my HF rig back here doesn't have any digital voice stuff on it. I did order that the box from David Rowe that'll do FreeDV on it when that gets produced and gets shipped from China. And that'll be my first actual experience on HF digital voice. And the only thing I've got on VHF has been the D-Star stuff. I'm not sure where I'm even getting all of this future thinking from, because I'm the guy that got a phone call from a marketing company some time ago, probably around 2000 or so. It was back when I was using this as my cell phone. You know, so some serious ancient technology. And I had a Palm Pilot, or one of the versions of Palm Pilots, and I thought I still had it sitting around and I was going to show it, but I couldn't find it. So I had the phone and a Palm Pilot, the phone for making phone calls. The Palm Pilot did basically, what, three things for me. It had my contact list, my calendar, and some note-taking capability. And I got this phone call from a marketing company that was doing a survey. And they asked me what I thought of having a device that would have all of those functions put together, integrated in one thing. I don't remember whether this was before or after the launch of the original iPhone. Because you remember what Steve Jobs would say. It's a phone. It's a music device. It's an internet browser, you know, however he put it. It's not three things. It's one thing. So they're asking me that sort of thing. And I don't know whether the iPhone had been out yet or not. I suspect not. They might have been even doing research for Apple. And here, you know, me, Mr. Future Think, Mr. Forward Thinker, said, nah, I would not be interested in something like that. I like having my phone be a phone and my Palm Pilot be a Palm Pilot. And the twain should not meet. Well, of course, the twain have met. Many more things have met. Couldn't live without my smartphone and my tablet. A new tablet. Ask me sometime about why I'm now carrying this big tablet instead of a little Nexus 7. There's a story behind it. So I'm not Mr. Future Think. But for some reason, I've latched onto this idea that digital voice is not the entire future of ham radio, but it has a place in the future of ham radio. And once again, if you go back to QRZ.com and read the comments on that followed the notice that I put up about the last episode, 193, talking to David Rowe, the guy that invented Codec 2, you just see the typical comments from hams who don't have much vision and think that the way things are when they get started, which was probably single sideband, is the way they should always be. And they can't even imagine the concept of a place for digital voice. There's a few people there that did, but a lot that didn't. And then along comes this issue of QST here on the tablet. This is the current issue, April 2015. And zip to the table of contents. And what I want to look at, one of the things I want to look at some point is this thing, this member input sought on draft HF band plan proposal. I tried to get David Sumner to come to a show about that, and he said he was too busy. And he passed me off, suggested someone else who I haven't been able to hook up with and do the program. But there's a bunch of stuff going on at the league that I want to do a program on. So, and it won't have anything or very little to do with digital voice. But this is the one that I want to look at here for now. A radical approach to single sideband. This is actually a reprint of an article in QST from 1955, from the April edition, the April issue of 1955. Yes, it's one of those spoof articles. What do they call it? April Fool's Day, an April Fool's Day article. It says, note the name of the author, say it quickly, Larceny Rap. It's got a call sign, though, W1OU. I haven't looked up to see who that is. What the article is basically saying is that, you know, hams are having trouble wrapping their heads around this concept of single sideband, which was something that was going on back in 1955. And his solution is something called a single sideband FM. That's kind of interesting in itself, because in 1955, FM was not a thing in ham radio, not particularly. Certainly repeaters, and the FM as we know it today was not a thing. But ARRL, QST, not totally ignoring FM. You know, some people had that concept. And so he's talking in probably technical gibberish about having some kind of an FM signal that's easier to tune in using an AM receiver doing slope detection, but is only a single FM sideband, so it's half the bandwidth. I don't understand it. But the interesting thing is, there it is in QST, the article that it was written because hams of the day were so upset about single sideband starting to encroach on their beloved AM. And this article was sort of designed to poke fun at them. I got my license in 1965, 10 years after this article came out. And at that point, the division was probably 60-40, 60% sideband, 40% AM. So 10 more years down the road, and AM was still a thriving part of ham radio. You know, now it's a legacy with one or two spots on a few of our bands. And sideband is the way ham radio is supposed to be. But these guys have a problem with digital voice. Okay, so this episode is going to be Bruce Perens, K6BP, from his talk at Orlando, the last program that I've got to edit or edited and ready to go from Orlando. And he's going to be talking about the HT of the future. We first encountered the HT of the future, let's see. Back here in episode 44, it was at the Tapper Digital Communications Conference, and it was Chris Testa, KD2BMH, his first appearance at a Tapper conference, and the first appearance of the HT of the future. That he's holding it right there, but let me play just a little bit of this for you as he introduces it for the first time.
Thank you, everyone. This was my first concept of a handheld software radio. It's in my hand. I've got your USRP and my laptop and an extra power supply. And I mean, that works, but it's not really what I was really trying to go for. And, you know, this is the standard software radio. I call it the cloud.
Okay, so that is Chris getting ready to, well, showing you his first HT of the future. He wasn't even calling it the HT of the future back then. He just called it practical handheld software-defined radio. Well, they've come a long way, and they don't have a product on the market yet, but they're getting closer and closer. And when you get toward the end of this talk, if you make it that far, Bruce will say that the first version of the HT of the future, and they have the brand name for it, is the white box, as opposite of the black box, where you don't know what's going on inside. The white box, it's going to be all open source hardware, open source software, for the most part. This talk, he'll show you the places where it's not going to be open source, the few spots where it doesn't make sense to be open source, or at least not to them. Oh, let me tell you about Arvin sitting back there before I go too much farther. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy these programs and you get something out of it, they cost me money to make, and all this fancy, I got the wide camera shot. No, wrong shot. There we go, the wide camera shot. All this fancy stuff, camera over there, camera back there, camera that I'm looking into. Stuff that I hauled to the ham fests, travel expenses, et cetera, et cetera. If you think all that stuff is worth getting these programs online, stop by hamradionow.tv. There it is right there, hamradionow.tv. Find Arvin's little icon, click on it, and you can make a contribution, either a one-time contribution or you can sign up for something every month. You know, a little something-something every month to Ham Radio Now. So hamradionow.tv. Okay, I think I'm ready. Let's head on down to Orlando, back to the sunshine one more time, and Bruce Perens and the HT. The HT of the future.
And you're okay for me to start now? All right, so welcome to the HT of the future talk, and I am Bruce Perens, Kilo 6 Bravo Papa, and Chris Testa, KD2BMH, and myself have a company called Algoram for algorithmic mobile radio, and we are going to make a HT that is absolutely nothing like the HT that you have today that will support the pioneering of digital amateur radio for, we're hoping, another decade or two. And it will also be a base in mobile radio, and I'm going to talk about the design here. So if you want to contact me, bruce@perens.com, that should be easy to remember, it's my name, and 5104-PERENS. And for the numerologists, I seem to have gotten as many 73s in my name as possible. So we're out to make the HT the future, but why would we need to change the way that HTs are? Well, HTs have a whole bunch of deadly sins. Okay, the deadliest sin about HTs is that they do the exact same thing today as 1950s Motorola tube taxicab radio. So remember those things? They took up the whole trunk of the taxi cab, and the cab had to have a bigger alternator just to run them. And they had carbon microphones, and they did essentially the same thing that RHT does 60 years later. Okay, so we want amateur radio to be innovative. Look what they had in 1950. Private line, or PL, same as today, repeaters, and they were wideband. Okay, the other deadly sins of the HT, you can't program them without the manual, okay? Pull out your HT and program it to scan a band. And then raise your hand if you've done it successfully. I don't think any of you are even going to take that dare.
I'm not even going to try.
Okay, so you can't do it without the manual. Most of us have never learned. You look at the buttons on your HT, they've got all these TLAs, three-letter acronyms. You have to look up what they mean. Okay, so pull out your smartphone. Look at all the three-letter buttons on your smartphone. Okay. So we should be able to program them without the manual. Okay, the only significant digital app on ham HTs today is APRS, and they actually handle that pretty poorly. There isn't really a good HT with a graphical APRS. For amateurs, there's actually a Part 15 one, and everything that your HT does is cast in concrete, which means that it's going to do, for the rest of its existence, exactly what it did on the day that you bought it. And I really like my smartphone because every once in a while, Google says, oh, here's Android 7. And the smartphone just gets upgraded and I look around, find some apps I can load. So my smartphone does what I want it to do. and does something different from the day that I bought it. So these are the departures that we need to make from HTs. So what's wrong with amateur digital? Well, the first problem with amateur digital is D-Star, DMR, Yasu System Fusion, APCO 25, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, there are very many incompatible amateur digital formats. There isn't a standard. And instead of arriving at industry unification, what we had was every manufacturer made their own. And when manufacturers like Yasu had the chance to make something that would work with the HTs of other manufacturers, they deliberately avoided doing that. Okay, other problems. Why does D-Star make such terrible noise? Just ask Gary's wife. And, you know, because it's going squeak, squeak, and she's going to turn that darn thing off. And proprietary or AMBI or IMBI codec is in all of those HTs. So this is a codec that you don't really have the right to modify. It's a black box. We actually have a specification for it, but it is currently covered by patents, which I'll talk about if I have enough time.
When did they expire?
Oh, that's a big story, actually, because it depends on some things that I could talk about. We can actually probably use those patents before the end of the grant date of the patents. And that's a big, long story. The codec, the AMBI codec in D-Star DMR Yasu System Fusion is inefficient compared to our own codec in open source, which is Codec 2. Theirs runs 4,800 baud or higher to get clear voice. We can do that in 1,200 baud. So much too wide bandwidth, which means wastes precious frequencies. Okay, who wants more frequencies? Everyone does. People would like to get ours. People look at them even harder because we're not using them. So we're going to solve that problem too. And all of these modes, FM and digital, have less range than could have had were they narrower bandwidth. Okay, so compare that to the smartphone, everyone. Manual?
We don't need no stinking manual.
Okay, and apps, for the most part, don't come from the manufacturer on the smartphone. You choose the apps and change them as you like. And the smartphone has a big, nice GUI, but the GUI is for the apps. I noticed some HT and mobile makers, they started making HTs and mobiles with really big screens, but the really big screens only do their stuff. Okay, what's that like? When I was a kid, we had this thing that you put on your bicycle and make it sound like a motorcycle, but it was still a bicycle. Okay, so if you're going to put a big screen on it, make it run apps. Okay. So I've evangelized the fight for open technology in amateur radio at these Tapper and ARRL digital communications conferences and elsewhere since D-Star came about. D-Star really pissed me off because here we were, the amateur world where everything was innovation and experimentation, and these guys came along and they gave us a black box codec that we couldn't get into. So now the amateurs were sort of forced to be the appliance operators of this black box codec. So I started to lobby about this and found this guy, David Rowe, VK5DGR. David actually is a PhD in voice coding. I did not, until I met him, understand that there was such a thing as a PhD in voice coding. And David had a 1997 thesis in which he'd written a codec, and he revived that thesis, which had sat on the shelf, and made an amateur radio codec, adding some modern art to it as well. Obviously, computers worked faster than when he started, so he could do things that he couldn't do in 1997. But because this is mainly based on technology over 20 years old, the patents that would have applied to it have all expired. So we have a really open codec. It is both open in terms of copyright and open in terms of patent. You get the source code and you can use it. And codec 2 currently runs on HF in a program called FreeDV, Free Digital Voice, which you can download, connect your computer to your transceiver and use it on the air, or Flex Radio in the 6000 series provides it as a button and it's built into the radio. And David is now experimenting with a GMSK, that's Gaussian minimum shift keying. It is a digital modem that does not require linear amplification and thus is battery efficient. And he's experimenting with that on UHF and VHF to run digital voice with codec 2 and the GMSK modem. Takes about 1.2 kilohertz of bandwidth. Compare this to D-Star at 6.25, Yasu System Fusion at 12, and all the other guys are at least 12, aren't they? Okay, so first of all, you got five times as many channels in the space that you're currently using for just one. Second, you have a 10 dB signal-to-noise improvement. Okay, who can use a radio that goes farther or uses less battery? Everyone can. Okay, so not just open, not just free software, technically superior, done by amateurs, not by billion-dollar industrial labs, you know, makes me wonder, why are we paying all these patent royalties anyway? We're not getting the innovation that we pay for. Amateurs are doing a better job. Uh-oh, but nobody makes an HT that runs it. So can I go down on my knees and beg, oh, please, ICOM, Kenwood, Yasu, please make an HT that uses my software, pretty please? I'll do anything you want. No. So Yasu comes out with System Fusion many, many years after we start talking about this, and indeed well after.
Briefly explain what it is. I don't know.
Oh, so what is System Fusion?
Yeah, what is it?
Okay, so D-Star was digital, right? System Fusion is also digital, but it's incompatible. Okay, you want an explanation of what it was? That's it. Okay, so why make another system? Can't figure it out. Okay, it could be that Yasu just wanted to own their own little monopoly. Okay, but unfortunately, they're sort of on the technical dark ages, really, because we had developed this whole codec. We had a narrower bandwidth system. We were talking about it at the ARRL Digital Communications Conference for years. Yasu never sends an engineer to that conference. They finally send a manager to announce when the product is done. Okay, so what this tells me is I cannot depend on ICOM Yasu Kenwood to make stuff that actually has innovation. And we as amateurs need to be innovative or we're going to lose our frequencies. And, you know, unfortunately, it's hard to attract young people when you're doing 50-year-old tech. So we need to be on the leading edge technologically, or people my age will preside over the end of amateur radio in their lifetime. And obviously I don't want that. So there's all these agendas here to drive innovation, etc. And Yasu, by the way, is always gonna get more abuse from me than other manufacturers, even though ICOM made D-Star, because Yasu did it when it was very late and they came out with a brand new dumb old system when that was no longer necessary. So let's look instead of the Yasus, ICOMs, and Kenwoods at the new wave in amateur manufacturers. So who is doing the innovative work in amateur radio these days? So look at Elecraft with the K3 and KX3, Flex Radio, which makes software-defined transceivers for end users. Now, I am part of an organization called Tapper. We make software-defined transceivers for rocket scientists. Okay, making them for end users is a useful thing to do. The Algram product, the first version to come out, is the rocket scientist version. The end user version is the next generation to come out after that. Step IR is here. Take a really good look at the crank IR. Now here's a guy, K3IR is here. He's the engineer behind all this stuff. Look at all of these buddy poles and other kinds of antennas out there and said, I can do better if I think outside the box, and he did. So I really like the crank IR. It is a really efficient antenna that I can carry on an airline flight. So insert your favorite example here. But the point is that Icom Yasu and Kenwood are not the innovative manufacturers anymore. And it happens every generation. When I was a kid, Collins, Drake, and Heathkit were the innovators. So we can't look to the big three anymore. And indeed, it's no surprise that Yasu made very conservative decisions in making their digital voice system. It's the new companies that can afford not to be conservative. Okay, so there are three opportunities for the new wave of amateur manufacturers. Software-defined radio is the first. Radio technology is in transition to software-defined radio. It has the capability of being changed and improved after it leaves the manufacturer. The conservative manufacturers will only use this opportunity to distribute updates of their own software. The forward-looking ones make open platforms. Okay, then apps and open. The consumer is used to the App Store. They buy an open platform. They get the software to run on that platform from third parties. Open source and makers have shown that loosely organized groups can exceed the industrial capability of companies and can manufacture real products that would not be profitable for conventional business. And then the end of modes. Amateur radio is facing the end of modes. While voice, text, and video were formerly their own modulations, these all become just different kinds of digital data carried over some form of digital radio. So what were formerly modes will just be different bandwidth of digital radio channels, and what mode those channels carry can change from packet to packet. And FreeDV has shown that we can preserve the sport of amateur radio while we do that. So put them all together, software-defined radio, open platforms, the end of modes. Each manufacturer in the new wave will bring their own ideas to that mix. We have digital fragmentation. I just talked about all the different and incompatible digital modes. And to neutralize that, the digital voice standard has to come from the amateur community. So by creating a 100% open source system and assuming that users will run it as an app on any platform, we hope to seed that community. So you can run open source apps on our platform. So now I'm going to talk about the features of RHT the future. So your smartphone is the user interface because these guys can make screens and computers cheaper than I can make them. Your HT stays on your belt and you talk through this. Okay, keeps the radio away from your brain, which is actually important. Yes, okay. More expensive versions for LAN mobile will have a touch screen built in and won't use your smartphone. So, you know, the firemen and the cops won't have to use your smartphone to talk through this. no need to read the manual. Onboard micro Linux system, onboard programmable gate array based on flash for battery efficiency. It has two filters. These are surface wave acoustic devices. Narrow band is either 15 or 30 kilohertz. Wide band filter of 1 megahertz. It can do 1 megahertz wide stuff, or it can do ultra narrow band.
30 is probably better, so you can interoperate with all the existing narrow band.
Yeah, yeah, 30 may well be better. And so you can put in a 1 megahertz channel spread spectrum, okay, and still be narrow band, but now it's spread, or you can put a wideband digital modem in 1 megahertz, or you can cut that down to less than 1 megahertz. Or you can do your normal narrow band channels, or using SDR, you can do ultra narrow band. So all in the same radio. Does all your conventional digital modes. You can run the amplifier in linear or non-linear mode. You just change how you're driving it. It can do video if necessary, using the video conferencing compression. Full duplex. So how do you do full duplex? Well, the way we used to try to do it is we had a separate transmitter and receiver on different frequencies, but that was hard from an analog perspective. The way we do it is by time division multiplexing. So we transmit for a small fraction of a second, then we receive for a small fraction of a second. And thus, we can do full duplex on only one frequency. Okay, this also gives us the capability to have TDMA repeaters, so that's time division multiple access. A TDMA repeater receives and transmits on the same frequency, no duplexer. Okay, what's the most expensive part of your repeater? It's that big metal can that was your duplexer. So what this does is it receives your signal, takes the packet, stores it for a moment, goes into transmit mode and retransmits it, and then it goes back into receive many times per second. So any HT can be a repeater. And repeaters use one frequencies. Okay, and another feature, modulations and modes are apps. Okay, there's always gonna be something new. Okay, your HT won't run anything new. What do we do about that? We give you the capability to put modulations and modes in an app, and thus you put in a new app and your HT does a new protocol. Go on.
You're gonna have a GPS receiver built in?
So there's a GPS receiver in here. The only reason you want a GPS receiver in the HT... What?
Accurate time for TDMA.
Yeah, the only reason you want a GPS receiver in the HT is to do a GPS disciplined oscillator. And so currently, to give you an idea of how precise you need to do, if you have a 1.2 kilohertz narrowband voice channel and you're at our maximum frequency, our $15 nice expensive TCXO that's one part per million will drift the entire width of that channel. Okay? So what do? You phase lock to the repeater. Okay, that's number one. Number two is your repeater is the one that has the GPS connected to it. And the repeater then has GPS disciplined oscillator. Or of course you can use rubidium, and if you have no end of money, you can use cesium.
The way most GPS receivers and phones work, they only work on demand, not constantly, and so it's not appropriate for this application.
So this is why I really think that the repeater should have that thing that, you know, that antenna, it's on base power, it's in view of the satellites all the time, it's not worrying about trees in motion, and you just phase lock to your TDMA repeater. The potential for mesh networking
is
there.
What about non-repeater use if you want to do TDMA, though?
I'm sorry?
Phase lock. Some go phase locks to the other guy. Who decides who's the master?
Well, if you are talking to a repeater, you have a protocol.
No repeater.
Oh, if you have to elect a master.
Okay.
Okay. So if you're doing mesh networking, somebody gets to determine what the frequency is, and that somebody may have in their protocol packet information about the accuracy of their oscillator. And this gets complicated because there's the hidden transmitter problem, and that is why I am giving you open source, because you're going to write that, not me. Go on.
Quick question. Previous experience with trunking systems, you have a control channel and then the actual channels that the units will switch off and onto
yes.
the instructions of the control channel. But
yes.
you're saying here the repeater is not a two-frequency item, it is a one-frequency, and the timing makes it look like a two-channel unit. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. That's TDMA, time division multiple access. And I can actually do that switching faster if I'm on one frequency, because the phase lock loop stays locked. And if I change frequency, I need a delay for my phase lock loop to lock up again. So to have a separate master transmitter, what I actually need is to put two PLLs in the radio instead of one. I don't happen to have that in this model. So there are some technical limitations there, but there are easy ways around them. And as I said, we don't provide the apps to exercise all of the system features, because we'd be coding for 10 years. We depend on outsiders to come up with them. and we have in the box 100 megabit Ethernet, Wi-Fi via the USB master. So we plug in a cheap Wi-Fi dongle and it becomes an access point. And Bluetooth should work, but
we need the dongle to have Wi-Fi?
We're probably going to package it with the dongle. But yeah, the dongle is connected to USB. Dongle is not on the main PC board. And oh, and by the way, this also will host a Raspberry Pi daughter board. So that's another expansion method.
Are you going to have the problem like Raspberry Pi that it's not really open?
Oh, no, we're not going to have that problem.
I mean, the video chip has to boot first and then...
No, see, we're not Raspberry Pi. All we did was we took the specification for the Raspberry Pi 2 Plus daughter board and implemented it. So any daughter board that plugs into Raspberry Pi, we can support if you port the driver. Okay, but we don't have the problems with the proprietary video chip and the USB that doesn't work, etc.
And the booting. For example, OpenBSD refuses to port to a Pi, even if they could, because of the openness problem.
Which is why a lot of people buy Beagle Bones, but that's outside of the topic of this talk. Anyway.
But you don't have that problem.
No, we don't have that problem. We use UC Linux, and U-Boot, and it works. So intellectual property rules should make sense, and get ready for this, people. You should have the source code for all of the firmware, and you should be able to load your own version of that firmware. You should have all the gate array code. You should be able to change it. The platform should come with the development software. So, everyone.
Use the source, Bruce.
All right. So, the intellectual property rules. The platform should be as close to open source and open hardware as possible without allowing Chinese cloners to eat our lunch. And there are lots of Chinese cloners out there, if you have not noticed. They make a copy of the USRP, and when people need service, they send them to Edis Research. Okay, that's really obnoxious, so we don't want that. Okay, so much of our platform is straight open source. Some things are restricted slightly to prevent manufacture of non-amateur equipment requiring type approval. without a commercial manufacturing license from us. Okay, so that protects our main revenue stream, which is non-amateur, while allowing you guys to do whatever you want.
Who's your other market other than hams?
Land Mobile, pretty much anybody who needs a radio between 50 and 1,000 megahertz, and that could even be, as you said before, IFs for microwave guys. Military, conceivably, I'm not sure I want to get into that market, but I think this could be a really desirable thing for them. Okay, so the radio design is called White Box. It's designed by Chris Testick, AD2BMH. He is a website, radio.testa.co. So White Box is the opposite of a black box. Everything is open. System architecture. It has a CMX991 IQ transceiver chip. This is sort of getting close to radio in a chip. The gate array is Smart Fusion 2, flash-based gate array and ARM computer on the same chip. There are clock chips, an amplifier, a Linux system, networking, etc. So let's see if I can get back here. So this is a second generation PCB, which I have with me. I can actually plug this in and it transmits, but since they put us in this tent where they normally show off the cows that the 4-H guys grew, I didn't really set up the demo, but this is the generation 2 of the radio board. And there you can see it larger. So as you can see here, this is the part really that goes in the HT. And you can see that that would fit in an HT. And this is the computer. And we obviously have made this a lot bigger than it needs to be. So right now, this is the mobile and base version. It's not the HT, but the design can obviously go to HTs. So let's go to the third generation PCB. The third generation PCB has a schematic complete, except we're changing the final amplifier. Layout is not done. It's in progress. It will not be miniaturized again. We're waiting for a later version to do that. Probably a 2-watt amplifier. The problem is it's really hard to make a 50 to 1,000 megahertz power amplifier that doesn't have parasitics, mixing of signals at its output, and is FCC legal. So it comes with a reasonably skimpy amplifier while we take months to figure out how to make a 6-band VHF UHF amplifier. Meanwhile, you can buy these single-band 30-watt amps from Down East Microwave. They're at the show. And these will plug in and let you do mobile or base on this radio right now. And so 6-band power amps are our next project. They're actually 8 bands because the British have 4 meters and someone has 70 megahertz. So we end up with a radio that can do 6 meters, 4 meters, 2 meters, 220, 440, 900, and maybe 1,300. Okay. Now, there are some bands in that discussion that you probably have never gotten on, because you never had equipment that could run them. I really don't like hams not having equipment to run the bands that we have, because we won't get to keep those bands. So we're trying to give you the capability to run on as many bands as possible. Why it's so hard to get HTs for some of these, I don't know. Maybe the manufacturers are in collusion in some way to preserve those bands for someone other than amateurs. I don't know. Never ascribe to stupidity that anything that could be a conspiracy. So this is the layout as it exists. You can see that there are some design rule violations like that. And so what we were doing when we took this picture is we were dragging stuff around and trying to make all the wires as short as possible within the internal layers of the PC board. But this will be the same size as this when we're finished with the layout. Chris is still working on this now. And we're going to send that out to manufacturer. And the enclosure selected is a Hammond case, just because it was easy. The mounting holes are present for other solutions. Both sides of both edges of the PCB where it slides into the Hammond case are bare copper chassis ground. They're custom punched end plates for the Hammond case. And we have a 3D geometry file from Hammond, which helps to make sure everything fits. So this is what we get when we render with the Hammond geometry in the PCB board program. So we have a reasonable idea that this will all fit together mechanically when it's done. There's another view of it. And so let's talk about the architecture of the hardware. This is separated into a baseband deck, which handles everything that's not RF, the digital analog converter, analog to digital, master oscillator, an RF deck, which handles RF, IF amplification, and IQ modulation. And a those are actually on the same PCB, and then there's a computer which is on the same module it is on now. And we buy that third party, and it works, and that takes a lot of the risk out of our design. They're separate ground planes for digital and RF. There's lots and lots of separate regulated DC buses. Baseband and RF are separate. Digital and analog are separate on each of baseband and RF. VCOs, voltage-controlled oscillators that are part of the phase-lock loops, have their own regulators. Why do we do that? Because we want to reduce phase noise. We also use a low phase noise oscillator. We tried to have as few PLLs as possible. There's still more than I'd like. Wide range 5-volt regulators feed 3.3-volt regulators. So here we have our baseband deck and our RF deck. And so the baseband deck has the human computer interface, the peripherals, the master oscillator, digital analog, analog to digital. There are signal and instrumentation DAC and ADC. So we have one that's the actual signal, and then we have one that does other stuff on the board, like measure your battery voltage and balance the IQ modulator. And then there's the computer gate array module, which is a separate piece. So here's the baseband DECs. So there's a human computer interface, which is a few digital inputs. There are the various peripherals, USB, Ethernet, etc. This is the computer. There's our one master clock oscillator. Codec is actually a digital analog, analog to digital converter. Aux codec is the instrumentation DAC and ADC. Power conditioning meets automotive standards. So if you look at automotive standards for power conditioning, the DC environment can be really nasty. There's this 200-volt pulse that you have to survive because there's a load dump when the starter motor stops. And the back EMF comes off the windings of your starter motor into your nice 12-volt system. There are reverse pulses and forward pulses, and we get special protection diodes that are made for automotive to take care of this. There's also a reversed conventional high current diode, which has lower resistance than the specialized diode, so that all of those negative pulses go away. There's a fuse. 5-volt regulators, again, feed the 3.3s. There is a single point ground on the board, so it meets at the antenna connector. So as you can see here, here's the power input. Here's some protection diode. Here are the high range regulators. These are like 5 to 40 volts in. and then they just feed 5 volts out. You can see we have a separate one for digital and for analog. And here is one of the 3.3 volt regulators. And so here are the analog supplies on the RF deck. So again, a 5 volt regulator. And here are three 3.3 volt regulators so that the VCOs are separate from the other analog stuff. And then there's a digital supply over there, so the digital stuff doesn't interfere with the analog stuff. On this board, we turned it on, and we saw this pulse on the DC rail every hundredth of a second. And it was the clock tick in Linux. So every hundredth of a second, the CPU woke up, and this drew a really incredible amount of current for a hundredth of a second, you know, some fraction of that, and then went back to sleep. And so we went and separated all the power supplies very carefully. So 110 megahertz master oscillator, it's temperature controlled, it's not voltage controlled. So what we do to phase lock is we phase lock other digital stuff in the system by changing the frequency digitally rather than steering this oscillator. Sub part per million, $15 crystal. We might eventually go to a less expensive one, but it's got low phase noise. We wanted to have a really nice commercial grade receiver. And it has input for an external 10 megahertz GPS disciplined oscillator or rubidium. So here's the temperature controlled oscillator. There's an optional clock buffer. We don't know if we'll need it, so we laid it out on the PC board and we can take it away. This is clock distribution, so everyone gets a nice clock signal. This is a reference conditioner for the external reference. And as you can see, we have protection diodes so you don't shoot static input in this input and blast the machine. So your GPS DO would go in here. And then we have a switch so you can switch from external clock to internal clock. The digital analog converter and analog to digital are clocked from the master 10 megahertz oscillator. There's an IQ balance circuit that runs on an instrumentation digital analog converter. And the way this works is that there are a number of bits on your signal, digital to analog converter, and then you want the balance of your IQ signal to be more precise than the number of bits. So you take what would be an additional lower bit and you make that adjustable analog signal. So there's a separate 8-bit DAC that drives that. So you can see the ADC and the DAC here. And here, you can see all of this stuff. This is to put that low-level balance signal lower than the lowest bit of the digital to analog converter. And if you don't do that, you get carrier leakage. So we want to make sure we don't have carrier leakage. This has JTAG. JTAG is a programming interface. The user should never need it because this device can self-program from Linux. You should just be able to drag a firmware file over to it when it's plugged into USB or downloaded from the Ethernet or Wi-Fi, and it should program itself. Okay, what if you write a program that totally bricks this device? You plug it into JTAG and you can rescue it, okay? Now, I think that I can make it rescuable by pushing a button most of the time, and that you will never need to use JTAG, but JTAG is there for factory programming and will also run in-circuit debugging for those of us who want to single step our processors.
How much will it cost?
I'm sorry?
How much will it cost?
JTAG?
Yeah.
There's a device that costs $30 called the Bus Pirate. If you've never heard of the Bus Pirate, look it up right now. It's really fun. It allows you to interface to any bus. It's really cool. So here's our processors and our JTAG. The major human interface is your smartphone, and that's coupled by Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. We like Wi-Fi because it's routable. You know, you can go across the country with this phone and still talk to your radio. And onboard interface for push-to-talk, paddle, and reset. These are electrostatic discharge protected. There is protection within the chip. So it's protected for human model, which is about 2,000 volts. And then we have external specialized protection diodes on top of those. You should be able to walk across a carpet and zap this on the input wires. There are LEDs for outputs, and there's a reset chip for the sagging power supply. So here you see the ESD protection diodes. This is the reset chip. So if your battery goes too low and then you start your car, the power comes up again, it resets it and gets it all started. You can see there are a bunch of flashing lights. You could also drive relays. And this is an input chip for these inputs here. So what we have here is we have a push-to-talk and a paddle. Okay, so you can write a little keyer program inside. I won't do it for you, but I'm sure it's easy to write. And this one is reset. So 100 megabit per second Ethernet. USB on the go. So that means it's either slave or master. I think it's got to be in master mode most of the time. And it provides power to devices. Separate connector for USB serial console. So this is USB on the go out here. This is a USB UART. So this is the famous FTDI chip. That's on the board. And here's the Ethernet MAC. And that's got the two little lights that are standard on Ethernet sockets. So I'll show you the RF deck. So we have the transceiver chip. I'm sorry?
Are you going to be using FTDI's manufacturer number and model number, or have your own?
You know, we're buying real FTDI chips right now. We're not sure we really care about that because this is the serial console. It's only the debugging interface. You plug into Ethernet for anything but debugging the kernel. Okay, because if you're debugging an application, you've telneted into the thing. So, you know, when I make the less expensive version of this or the HT version, that chip might not be there. It doesn't matter. Okay, so this is the RF deck. So we have power, which I've showed you. We have something called the gateway chip, which I'll explain. We have two PLL synthesizers, one for IF and it stays at one frequency, one's for RF and it moves around to your operating frequency. This is the IQ modulator chip. There are four plug-in bandpass filters, choose your bands, TR switch and power amplifier. So this is the gateway chip here. So the gateway may become a microprocessor, but right now it's a CPLD. It provides glue logic to control various systems. And it does something we have to do for regulatory purposes. It enforces cellular scanner lockout. Okay, because we have this law called ECPA, and I can't let you program this device to eavesdrop on analog cell phones. Okay, since they are analog cell phones, probably time to fix the law. Okay, so
nobody knows how to build a mixer, huh? Nobody knows how to move that to another frequency.
If you would like to take on this legal project, sir, or even donate to it, just talk to me. You know, there are so many projects and so few Bruce. So any help I can get with this stuff, I appreciate. So the IF synthesizer stays on one frequency.
What frequency is that?
I think it's 90 and then within the CMX 991 is doubled to 180, but I'm not sure. So
shielded so you don't have problems with
There are cans. Yeah. We have cans on this board because there's a computer, too.
Yeah.
The computer has a 25 megahertz crystal for Ethernet and a 25 megahertz crystal for USB. So we wanted to have cans so we wouldn't be interfered with those. The cans are not soldered on. You can pry the tops off. There's the RF synthesizer. Okay, so this is another PLL. As you can see, there's, well, you can't quite see it, but it has its own separate power supply, so you won't get phase noise. This is the main IC. Okay, so here's a really busy page of the 20 pages of schematics. And so this is CMX991. It's an IQ transceiver. And it actually has an IF oscillator in it. But in this version, we found the IF oscillator and parasitics at audio, so we decided to put it on our own. And there are bandpass filters here. We're showing the 1 megahertz one, but there's also the 30 or 15 kilohertz one. there's an RF log detector. The RF log detector is a self-test and diagnostic component. It lets us receive our transmission. And what this does is it allows us to balance the IQ modulator at boot time. So we can make sure that even if your components have drifted, that you have the excellent carrier suppression that we want to give you. It's balanced at startup, and then it's thermally tracked to keep it in balance during operation. There's a thermal detector on the same pad as the IQ modulator chip. All of this analog stuff is still problematical. Digital mixers are a possibility for the future. They get rid of some of these problems of, you know, your IQ modulator drifts when it gets warm. So here, this is the RF log detector. You can see we have a RF switch here, so we can switch that in, or we can switch in the PA. This currently is just a microcircuits, mini circuits PA, but we're going to replace it with one that does 2 watts. That was a 100 milliwatt one. Four plug-in bandwidth filters. Pick your bands. We could make this 6 in a mobile or base unit. We just put 4 on the PC board that we're designing. And of course, you can make them external. So as you can see, we have RF switches and we have all these different filters. You make your own filter and stick it in there. Front end has an LNA and it has a noise diode for self-testing. So just as we can receive the signal that we're transmitting for self-testing and calibration, we can provide a signal for receiving. So you can see the RF noise source up there. That's actually the highest voltage component on the board. It was actually problematical to run that at 5 volts. So that's running before the 5-volt regulator, I think. And low noise amplifier before the bandpass filters. As you can see, we use a lot of RF switches. And this is a IF bandpass filter, so that's got surface wave acoustic devices as the major filter. And this is one of the bandpass filters that you would plug in. This one is for 6 meters. So, yes, I've just showed you 20 pages of schematics really, really fast. And so what were the issues? It's easy to make a QRP transceiver. It's actually more difficult to make it work from 50 to 1,000 megahertz with amplification. Making it legal was the hardest. We want to get all of the spurious emissions down below 60 dBs that we can amplify above 25 watts. There's a dual licensing system, so if you want to make a commercial version that's not for hams, you have to pay us. If it's for hams, you don't have to pay us. Software or hardware ambi is possible. There's a company showing here that has a USB ambi chip. So you can plug it into this thing and it'll do ambi and hardware. The other thing is we actually have a software version of ambi, but patents are still in force, which prevent us from using the software version of ambi. I wrote two amplifier biases, but it's really if you want to be nonlinear, you just drive the amplifier harder. So the ambi patents, this is not our main mode of operation because we use Codec 2, which is open source. But if we want to be compatible with D-Star, DMR, APCO 25, and Yasu System Fusion, we have to use that ambi or imbi in the case of APCO 25, I think, codec chip, until the ambi patents expire. Okay, now I am not going to write the D-Star app and the DMR app. I'm going to leave that to you guys because this is an open platform. So the ambi 1000 patents become unenforceable, we think, about a week after Hamvention. And the reason is not the expiration date of the patents. It's that their first use in commerce was actually before that date. They published papers in IEEE, etc. And the patents become unenforceable sometime after that publication. And so we think that ambi 1000 actually did everything necessary for D-Star, and JARL had access to it when they designed D-Star. Although when D-Star came out, it was based on an ambi 2000 chip. So we have an intellectual property specialist who's working with me. I'm also an intellectual property specialist. It's how I make my living. And neither of us are lawyers, though. We're the guys who tell lawyers about technology. And so we want to put all of this through a lawyer and have a lawyer actually tell us in writing that these patents will be unenforceable after Hamvention. And so we're working on the technical data for the lawyer. We will pay the lawyer. The lawyer will not work for free. That's what pro bono means. To be fair to the lawyer, because we expect to make money on this. But we appreciate good rates if any of you are intellectual property lawyers. We do have some candidates already. So we're going to try to make it possible for you guys to all run software ambi this year. So that's the end of the talk. I've actually got a minute and a half for questions before the next person is supposed to take the room. Thanks very much. Any questions, please?
Have you done any analysis of the capabilities of the FPGA and the requirements for, you know, possible different bandwidths and data modes to know whether or not there's enough in the FPGA to do any other required digital filtering that you don't have the SAW filter for?
There are two answers. First of all, we did a ton of analog analysis. We did all this RF path analysis, which I didn't show you, but we have that stuff, and we did that so that we could see about gain and phase noise and SN and all that stuff. Second, there are a whole series of gate arrays that fit in this box. And we expect that most people will use the $18 part that only has 11 multipliers and 6,000 gates and an arm. However, there are parts with 50,000 gates and 100 multipliers. And so you can order this with more oomph and probably not run it on the battery, depending on just how oomph you're getting.
Does any of that now cost me $20,000-$30,000 a seat?
No, I mean it's hundreds of dollars. It's not thousands.
Well, but I am going to have to pay for the software now.
Well, I didn't talk at all.
Route software.
I didn't talk at all about how we develop the software for the gate array. So there is a piece of non-open source software that creates the bitstream for the gate array. And by the way, making open source gate arrays is another project I'd like to work on. And but that is free, even though it's not open source. We take that and we program it with something called MyHDL, which is a Python platform for writing HDL code, and it outputs actual HDL. And the nice thing is that it lets you test it all in Python, and it is a rapid development platform as opposed to writing directly in HDL. Let me take another question. Go on.
On the FPGA, Xilinx, Altera.
It is a Microsemi Smart Fusion 2 flash-based gate array with ARM on the same die as the gate array. And the flash base is important because of the battery. Any more questions? Go on.
MySDL, is that what Chris Testa presented at?
Yeah, so Gary has in Ham Radio Now 4 hours or something of videos on Chris teaching how to do gate array programming. I think you may actually have to put in a little time after you watch all four before you can do it. But it's an open source platform.
And it's a good tutorial for an old electrical engineer who the gate array stuff happened after I stopped in 95.
Okay, if you have not been to the Tapper ARRL Digital Communication Conference. Okay, I worked for Pixar. When I want to be with smart people, I go to that conference. You know? I had an office across the hall from Steve Jobs, okay? The smartest people in the room are at Tapper and maybe AMSAT. And that really applies to the whole industry. And I go and hang out with these guys for fun. There is no one smarter. We in amateur radio have not been as innovative as we should. We can fix that. Okay, I'm hoping that what I've given you here is part of how. Thanks very much. We're out of time.
And I've only come back here at the end to close things out and remind you one more time that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So if you got something out of this program and you're still sticking around, you know, the 15% or so of you that that hang around to the very end, stop by hamradionow.tv, click on Arvin's icon, and help us out. Appreciate the folks that that do that. Some very generous hams out there. Not all hams are cheap. Thank you, Bruce Perens. We'll be in touch with you soon to find out progress on the white box and the HT of the future. I'm Gary Pierce. KN4AQ. Over. And out.